I started in Houston, Texas, kind of Pedro's Alisatas in Cambri. Grew Pastor Milano, Pastor Nick Mitchell, and me, Sasa Kader, Chijamati Jamenales, Wobushela's Pastor Ronnie, or Pastor Teddy, that's for that. And then Sasa Pastor Nicky from Philadelphia, but not from Philadelphia, last Cambri. We started our Christian walk in Houston. And we started the first church in Houston, Plodam Cambri, that they don't want us to enter, which was Plodam. I was 18 years old. Then from there, we moved on to LA in 1980. And we was on no bus with suffering. We stayed there 3 years. The Lord told me, all right, Mustika, I'm now about 23, 24. From Hollywood, the paradise of paradise, to hell. We went to Philadelphia, and I stayed in Philadelphia 9 years at Plodam Cambri. And from there, I moved on to Baltimore, Plodam Cambri. And from there, I stayed in Baltimore 5, 6 years, Plodam Cambri. Then from there, I moved on to Jalapuri, Palajim. Long border group, we stayed in Miami 2, 3 years. And I was tired of running church and the problems of it. In all the churches, I want 2, 3, 30, 40, 20 people. And I told the Lord, Pimplin, what a burden, Pimplin. Can you do me a favor and take this burden from me? Just let me be a normal Christian. I don't want to, I'm not going to gamble, people. I'm not going to drink. That's not in me. I'm a born-again Christian. I just don't want the headache. Did you ever feel that? Then, last 2 weeks, I left Baltimore and went to Miami. The biggest thing I did in Miami was go fishing. Every
other
man, Pastor Ruby, the world of Danny Miller, the elder. And we went there, and I stayed 3 years. I was laughing and jumping on the outside, but me and Valentina was crying on the inside. And the Lord spoke to me and told me, are you ready to serve? And I didn't believe I didn't hear that voice. No. I want you to get up, and I want you to leave Miami. And I want you to go on in your title company. No. A month later, the voice came to me again when I left church. I said, I'll give you one chance. If you reject it right now, I'll never use you again. I want you to go on to the church in New York. Some documents I need to do. I need them on a movie that in the story that will get so doctors. I'll go on to the church. Now I think for him to cheat or hospital. If soon as I put the key in the door and turn the lock, if the phone rings and somebody calls me from New York, Shalomani, under the list will curse. So give me a key on the door, and before I turn it, I hear the phone ring. I walked in. I pick up the phone, warm up in here. Hello, what's on? Tell me what's going on. I said, well, Steve, good pastor. That's what he said. Let me touch you. No normal man. He doesn't go to the Pushas to say this because I'm in the Kandari in New York. All right, I'll be there in 2 weeks. So now, the day before I'm going to New York, I'm at the table, me, Valentina, and Mahadeo. I had a shabbat, Mahadeo Tichas, and I was very close with my mom. I go off from him. She's always Steve Dustin, we don't suck a lot of messages. Shut up. Shut up, baby. Quickly. Only the top study, if I go, I'm not coming back. Still get a offer. And I wait Monday. I know what. Let's put God to the test. You know how? I'm already packing the car for tomorrow. They're not going to rebuild the church. Somebody's going to knock on the door and give you 500 to go. Shabbat, I did come out there. While I'm taking this to me. And then I put up with a warm stain. See, I was going to the racetrack. Something came and told me, shall they cost me another 500 to shall on New York? Are you going to New York? Level 500. So they won't pull along. I'll swim. I'm giving you a fast thought from the cycles coming up. So they will be. Got him on the New York Cup. And mine is 1400 miles. You can't make it one day. So I went 1700 miles. Then we got this. So then, while I'm sleeping, we got snow. Come to me, downtown Manhattan. What have you been among it? It's all in my mind. No problem. We start in the morning, got to New York. I'm there at home on the last container. Hiding in my cousin, the last one in the car. To me, I've been in New York, I kind of a little child, it's like a cat. They come up. That's what I could afford, but whatever. I'll take this to New York. So now, I live a one for the money. We want to take you to a steakhouse, the cost. No, I don't want to go to a steakhouse. I want to go to Little Charlie's. No. We take a Little Charlie's. We saw a woman, proper, Mindy. Let's go to a little steakhouse that I know will be quiet. Or a steakhouse, just this big. There's me at Jim's steakhouse. Saturday night, Shabbat. And we're in God's house. I'm a pastor. I'm giving you 100. While I'm in the restaurant, I got waiting for a table. I got money that will go on there. Not he. I said, that was my mistake. Oh, I'm sorry, sir. He gave us one of them. You're not from here, right? No. I'm from Florida. Well, last night, God came to me and told me to give you this address. Well, what do you mean? I don't know. I just told me to give you these letters on my shelf in the morning, Sunday morning. It can't be taken. It's him on the snow. So, is this guy trying to get my attention? Last but not least, revivals are over. It's January. I just cut up my. I am freezing. Go on, you know. I want to hold on. Hold on. Stevie, if the Lord wants you here, he'll do something. But if you want to go home, go home. While I'm eating from the third floor across the street from the diner, go home. Next time, they're Joe. Stevie, who will get your name on cover? Come on. Okay, I'm just not going to serve. Can I help you? I help me once. To put on company on the couple of photos, and then got up on the side of the charm in them. I never look back after that. The church has been there for 20 years. And lately, I learned the good, the bad, and the ugly in the church. I learned how to look at good things. I learned the bad things, and I try to separate them. I know what hurts the church. I know what hurts the spirit. I know when I do things I was want to do them, whatever, don't you ever do that. I know when he has to smack me. I know how to do it, don't want to watch out. I know my safety is over there. tough chunk of life, you know, I'm sorry about you. Please, dear Lord, I won't do it again. There's nothing wrong with doing wrong. It's wrong when the Holy Spirit tells you you're wrong and you don't repent of it. Whatever you do, if you come and say, devil, I'm sorry, help me, and repent, you'll be all right. Night come, I'll deal with it. So now God has given me a teaching ministry. Sardis, a child of woman, they are then worked out under the risk of coming. And the main key that God gave me, Tainaka Wong, is order. Order. Dekara's worked out. See, they were 40, 50 guys. And not a pin could be heard. Well, if there's 700 that had to be taken, you understand? If there's 700 people that had to move the little church, cannot do the long love deal, because that's not called the mighty table. And then they come in on Sunday, say, I'm sure if that's a lot more. But we're talking about New Yorkers, Brown. Hey, where you go? I'm going to kill you. That kind of attitude. But on the Kandari, there's not a movement. There's not a walk. Every church is going to be like this. And God gave me that dependence from the deal. I'll have you put to whatever you want. But I don't want to call that out of women. I want to make sure I let us. So now, we're into doctrine. Osama Bell, Douglas Abel, and then we're going to break. Then we're going to come back and I'm going to give you the main teaching. And we're left in doctrine. There's going to be a little empty, 30, 40 minutes. Probably can have to do. I'm teaching, I'm out of Pastor Ron. Now I'm going to do my church. One song. She get one chino of his uncles coming 1 hour. That's you know Monday. Called Billy Graham, that's that you know Josh. I Monday. So we're teaching on the fellowship 20 to 30 minutes at most. The Sichono Mamus, it's not about the pastor, it's about the congregation. Alas? So, hi, sir. Oh, Douglas,
what's important for me before we go into the word, Manglemas, if the boys could help us just for one song to worship. Could you do this for me, please? I believe that worship prepares us for the word. Amen. And what I'm going to share with you tonight has something to do with that. Amen? So, whatever God leads you. This is why we're here. We're men of God, seeking God, asking God to touch our hearts. And that's why we're here, seeking direction. Inspiration. Please, Pandavento Maria, come. One song. Mugada, Devla, we are here because we need your counsel. We are here because we need your help. As pastors, elders, deacons, ushers, Christians, Drubola, make your help. We cannot do it without your Devla. Help us, Lord. Tu sana marizor. Tu sana maro shelter. Tu sana maro hiding place. Help us, Lord. Open our hearts. Open our minds. To be the men of integrity. the spiritual men of God you called us to be. Help us. Have your way.
And we want more of that. Okay?
22 years ago, Pastor Sapka goes to my papo to evangelize. And I heard a song. I did it, Penel, Nazuria, Chiro Ilo Pala. How did it start? Alright. That song, I'm hearing it, and God is ministering to me. This is your life. This is what you need to stop doing. And I prayed and I felt something. I experienced for the first time the presence of God. And ever since that, I got hooked. I want more of what I felt. Because all my life, I would buy something that made me happy. If I want a car, I go and I buy it. That made me happy. But it was only for a time. I went and I bought a suit. It made me happy, but it was only for a time. Whatever I wanted, I would buy it. So Karkao, when I felt this beautiful, unbelievable, life-changing experience, I wanted it. In the same mentality, says, what do I need to do to get more of it? Thinking that I need to buy it, purchase it. And then God shows me, no, Naikodo mentality. All I need to do is desire it. And it will always be there. And wow, I didn't know the Bible. I don't know nothing. I just know this experience is what I want. And that experience led me to teach Sunday school. That experience led me to be behind the cameras and audio and you name it, in the back, in the church. And that experience led me to be a teacher. That experience led me to be an evangelist. That experience led me to be the pastor of the church today. That experience. Amigo Mandel, Pastor Stevie Arachia, Pindamonde, I want you to teach about hunger. Danny, I need you in the back, please. Odivano, hunger. When he came to me, and he said it, as soon as he said hunger, God gave me the whole sermon. That's when I know it was from God. In less than a minute, all he said was hunger. Boom, okay. I know what God wants. Right click. Now I want you to look at the word.
The base is so many stuff.
Hunger.
Right click, Pastor?
Yeah, right click.
On the computer?
Yes.
No.
It's double screen curves. So you're going to have to exit it and put it up again.
There we go.
Now,
Kurt, you got this?
Hunger. Let's just take a few minutes. This is a 15-minute teaching. It's not long. But I want you to think about this hunger. If you know there's a great restaurant, you go back to it, right? Yes? You would not say, Najan Kutsi, unless you don't want the restaurant to be in Omega Kahoon, right? Where we know it's good, we want more, and we go back. Why don't we do that with God? We know what we need to do. You remember your experience with God. We have a few young people here. Maybe you never had an experience with God. Maybe you grew up in church. Maybe you just know that this is what you do. You get there early, set up, do, and this is your life, church. But you never had an encounter with God, an experience with God.
Amen.
So you don't know what it is to be hungry. You just know this is what you always eat. Well, when you experience God, His peace, His love, His mercy, that hunger fuels the anointing that later falls on you to serve your people. And you should desire more of that hunger. Want more. Now, I'm going to give you some scriptures. Matthew 5, 6. Blessed are those who what? And thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Luke 6, 21. Very simple scriptures. Blessed are you who hunger when?
Now.
Now. For you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will have. Okay. Blessed are you who hunger now. I want you to experience for a few seconds in your heart right now. Are you hungry for God? Oh, Douglas, I serve God. You don't know me. I'm a deacon, elder, usher. I'm a servant by the congregation, dedicated. I give my tithes, I pray, I'm faithful to the church. But you're not faithful to God. I want you to think about what I just said. You're more faithful to church than to God. Yes, you hunger, but for the wrong reasons, for the wrong thing. Go ahead. Kakotimano, hunger originates from the word desire. Could everybody say desire?
Desire.
All right. What is your desire? Let's think about it. Okay, hunger and thirst for God. But now let's look at the word desire. What is your desire? Well, eventually I want to have authority on the congregation, be a choir, be the choir leader, preach, minister, make a name for myself. Yes, that's my desire. Your hunger is in the wrong area, wrong place. Your desire, na importa. If I could only get this man's job, then that's where I want. That's when I'll be happy. When I can do what I want. This is my desire. So now we're juggling. God's desire, my desire. What's more important? Our desire will always overcome what God wants for you. Because God wants you to be the one kachiki choke. God wants you to be the last.
Yep.
God wants you to be the humble little guy. The carpet sometimes that people step on. We don't want that. So we desire what we desire. What we want, not what God wants. So, let me give you the scripture. Matthew 6, 20. Store your treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there your what?
Desires.
Of your heart will also be. So, let's see. God, amount of treasure, or title, position, authority, power, lust of this world, that's my treasure. Yan sa mabuti malis ka nilip manus and a little joke. But ang nikodo joke po hil peskubilo.
Yeah.
Ang klero chachimos. Well, that's what happens with us. That's what happens. So now, hunger, desire, and now your treasure. How can you have a hunger, go ahead, if you never tasted, if you never tasted of the Lord? We think we have the hunger and the desire, I seek, I trouble tabel, and the kangari, but we're not functioning with that desire leading katarosun to duho We are functioning in the flesh. We are running the church in the flesh. With our own fleshly desires. Do you understand this? Because again, church, we have been taking over the church as pastors, elders, teachers, ministers, and we've been running the church with our own desire and not the desires of the Holy Spirit. We have been doing what we want, how we see church should be. And as servants of God, we need to hunger and thirst for His righteousness. Like a whole complicating thing. We just don't know what to hunger for simply because we never tasted.
That's right.
If you tasted, then your life would not have been the same. Maybe I would have stayed in Sunday school and never got out of there. Maybe I would have stayed on choir for 20 years and never done nothing. If you have been serving in God, in church, in one place, and that's it, you're happy because you're head usher, choir director, I have Shinan Kotzet for 20 years.
Come on.
I'm sorry, that's not God's will. You're supposed to teach, preach, evangelize, and do great things for God. It's not just in this building. It's out there in the streets and the highways and byways. But we are to taste of the Lord. Psalms 34:8. Taste and see that the Lord is good. All the joys of those who take refuge in Him. Psalms 42:1. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. You know why a deer seeks that spring water that's in between a valley, very hard to get to? But yet, Jal Kotze, you know why Jal Kotze? It's hard, but Jal, because when Jardia Kodosi Lashimos, Kotze to move them off. Why don't we do that? You know that you experience God on your knees at your house, at a revival, on your face, on the ground, and then we never go back. We put the suit, we get the pin, and then we look the part. But we never go back there. You know why? Because we never really tasted the goodness of God. We only experience something that's emotional. I've been out, wow, this feels great. I like the goosebumps, I like the hype. Ray, the boys blew it up. And that's always our attitude. We need to show Arizona what church is great. We need to show the United States that we are a church. Really, we're the body of Christ. Jesus' blood shows you what I'm talking about. Not money, not our blood. So we need to go back. If you had a taste, if you had an experience with God, then you go back there. And what we do? We forget about the love. Sabi na Bible. We forgot. Right? We forgot. We need to go back there. And do the things we've done before. Night, complicated. Simple. But yet we don't do it. Matthew 6:33. Seek the kingdom of God. That's the key. Above all else, and live righteously, and He will give you everything you want. you need. Everything you need. So I want to paint this picture right now, and I'm going to leave you with this in your mind, okay? Go ahead. We're seeking God's kingdom. We wear the suit. We come to church. We serve the people. But nowhere do we have that reflection, that compassion, that love that we encountered that brought us to God. We completely put that aside. You know what people see? They see the suit. They see what you could do. Your ability. They serve God. But they don't see nothing else. The only Jesus they see in us is what they see in this building. So, this is the truth. Seek first what you want, what you desire, what you like, and then when you get what you want, then try and fit in God somewhere in your life. That's the scripture that we wrote. That's the scripture that we wrote. Now, how is it supposed to be? Go ahead. This is the church that we're supposed to be. Before we do anything, we need to see God's direction. We need to seek God's wisdom. We need to, Douglas, of course we gotta pray, but things need to be done. Это моё problem. If you hunger and thirst for God, then you need to have a taste of God. If you hunger and you're thirsting for God without even tasting God, you got a problem. Because what you're desiring is not what God wants for your church, for your life, for the ministry, your ministry. Every one of you has a ministry. Whether it's in the church or in your home, you have a ministry. Ariad, God is going to do something tonight to heal the city of Arizona. People that are sick physically, people that are sick spiritually. We could do this. Okay, what suit we're going to wear? I hope the audio is going to be good so that Jimmy could blow it up tonight. And we're going to be excited. And that's all we're expecting. I can't wait to experience it. I want to see life changing.
Amen.
Tonight. Yeah. Miracles tonight. Now, what am I going to do for that? I'm going to hunger, and I'm going to be thirsty, and I'm going to desire, which means going back to my hotel room and staying on my face for as long as God wants me to pray for this city, to pray for my city and our church. What are you going to do about it? Echo direction, church. These are simple problems that we don't even look at anymore. Because it's okay. Yes, we're hungry, but not for what God wants to give us the taste. Not for what God has for us. So in closing, you need to come to a conclusion. Yeah, I'm hungry for God, but I really never tasted the goodness of God. It's time that we ask God, Lord, if I never had an encounter, Pastor Steve has been preaching this for 1 month through the entire time on the West Coast. An encounter with God should be genuine,
amen.
Real, not emotional, not because the whole world is doing it, It is a one-on-one relationship with God. And that's how life changes. When you taste it of God, I tell you the truth, change will happen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. God bless you.
Of what God
called us to have. And when you run the church on your ability, on your strength, on your talent, on your know-how, this is exactly where Satan wants to keep God's servants. He's not looking to break the church up. He just wants the church to stay under God's anointing. No, under man's ability. When people come to the altar,
they sing the song and they walk away.
When people hear the word, they stand up. This is all stand up, beautiful. And all, we become professional Christians. We stand up, we sit down, we give our tithes, and we walk out. I didn't like the service. I didn't feel it tonight. I know I liked the service. It was very good. He blew it up. But we go outside and live the same life. It's because the anointing of God is not upon the minister, the ministry, the servants, and it's exactly what Satan wants for our churches. Because he's God's where he wants us. Because if you see the, what does the scripture say? The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. You see, God's hand is always upon the church. Satan can't destroy the church. But so what Satan does, because he's very clever, is he allows the servants to get a little puffed up, a little head knowledge.
That's right.
A little pride. A little routine.
Yep.
It allows us to do things under our emotions and our pattern. No anointing. Deuteronomy. I'm powerful. I'm ability. Well, I'm going to share with you just a little while. I'm going to take my time. Well, make a long story short, the first temple was built by King Solomon. Found in the book of Kings. And he builds the temple, and the Ark of the Covenant is in there. And when they built the temple, the fire came down when they dedicated it. Did he lost? The anointing of God, fire. You can't even begin to imagine. Well, Huth Vamyatidi, later on in life, the king Solomon started doing some crazy stuff at the end of his life, started taking it for granted God's anointing, take it for granted God's people, take it for granted Sudalis Udalam the Kiskabas, Sudalis Kangri, and they started getting a little routine. Well, years down the line, I mean, it took it to Babylonians. And they literally tore down the entire temple. Kharei Kangri, Hainamai Kangri, 40 or 50 years, Jerusalem stays with no church. Can you imagine a city? You know, I said something amazing. What do you think is the most dangerous city in America? Where would you think that?
Chicago.
Huh? Detroit. Give me another one.
Chicago.
Right? A city without a hospital. A city without a hospital, because it's Shinanai. There's no way to keep, you gotta go 100 miles by the time that comes. When? Then I'm told, if I had a heart attack, you just gotta go an hour and a half to get me to the hospital, I'm dead. A city without a hospital is the most dangerous city in America. A city without a church is the most dangerous city in America. And at this time, Jerusalem was in ruins, was in desolate, nigh Kangri, nigh in worship, nigh Orasai, nigh Panchi, nigh, and it is exactly where these people was at. Until God decided to change it. He said, okay, it's time. It's time for my church to get rebuilt. It's time maybe we could do it a different way. Maybe it's time that men of God start rising up and we'll learn from our past mistakes and we'll learn from our defeats and we'll learn from our weaknesses and we'll learn from putting the wrong servants and we'll learn from doing the wrong things and we'll start living a better life and then I'm going to bring a new church and God is going to start doing it different this time. Amen?
Amen.
So he speaks to a servant by the name of, I can't pronounce his name, Zerubbabel? The Lord gave a message to the prophet Haggai to Zerubbabel. And the message was, it's time to rebuild my temple. I want my temple back. I want the anointing of God back in my church. I want when people come to the altar to be healed, to be set free, to be delivered. I want revival back in Jerusalem again. Who wants revival? Who wants revival back in their church again?
Amen.
We should give God glory because we need the fire of God back in our cities and back in our homes in Jesus' name. So verse 2 of Ptolemaia, and this is what the Lord said. The people are saying, The time has not come yet to rebuild our hearts. But Paul, in a couple of years, my job Sunday, I can't get that serious. Listen, you see, anytime you're going to do the, let me see a sermon, how many sermons we got? Anytime you're going to start to get serious, anytime you're going to seek after God's anointing, there's going to be people that's going to say, you're doing a good enough job. Stay right where you are. The opposition will always come against God's people. So get ready. If you're looking to serve, if you're looking to get forward, just understand one thing, that you're going to get a word. People say, it's not time yet. I'm here to tell you, today is the day of salvation. If you've been called in the ministry, if you've been called, God has a plan for you in Jesus' name. I couldn't get one. So the Lord sparked, everybody say spark.
Spark.
Enthusiasm in Zerubbabel. The Lord spoke a word through the prophet. It's time to rebuild my church. Time to rebuild my temple. And it sparked enthusiasm. How come the word of God isn't sparking enthusiasm in our people today? Repent. Why? Here, the prophet comes and speaks a word, and the word is to rebuild the temple. Nay, forgive your enemy. That's something very simple. He's saying, go build a temple. Something uncomprehendable. And this Gejol sparks an enthusiasm in him. And 23 days later, starts to lay the foundation. And he gets everything together, and now he lays the foundation of the church. And it takes him 2 years, and he's got the foundation laid. And then opposition sets in. I'm going to get somewhere, trust me. Opposition sets in. I don't think of the Samaritans, like Pastor said yesterday. But you want to help too. Where are your brothers? We want to build the church too. The next thing you know, the Persians, who was supposed to back the Temple of Eid, was a declared about it. You know what? We're done. We're not interested no more. Forget it. Stay there. We're not interested in the church. Opposition comes in. And for 17 years, the church stays unfinished. Just the foundation. There's a lot of churches that are unfinished spiritually. 17 years, Miss Lord, it can be begun. Your foundation might be laid. Your foundation might be laid, and it's the right foundation. It's the right doctrine. It's the right Trinity. If everything is perfect. But that's all it is. It's just the foundation. Until you start obeying the will of God, until you start putting God first again, until you start doing the things of God, God will start building that house the way He wants it and not you. So after 70 years, you don't have the finances, you don't got the manpower, how's He going to do it? But you see, that's a great place. I'm not going to keep you too much longer, 5-10 more minutes. But I got something amazing. This is all just the foundation. We're not there yet. You see, it's a good place to be in when your goal is unattainable. You know why, Pastor? Because you can't do it. That means God can.
That's right.
And it was 17 years. Nine of them can't have no help, can't do it. And then God sends the prophet back to him. Go to Haggai chapter 2. It's a little bit of a reading, but we're going to get there. Does anybody remember this house, the temple? Does anybody remember this house, the temple, in its former splendor? Can you remember Can you remember Cheches when the choir sounded like angels? Can you remember Can you remember how beautiful the church used to be? Full of the fire of the Holy Spirit, full of the anointing of God, miracles. People's life change. People can't wait to get to church. Where now we have to make, we'll make a barbecue. We'll make a Hawaiian party. We'll make this kind of a gimmick. And we'll do that. Well, we're having Taco Tuesday, a taco truck. Well, we gotta be there.
They didn't have a taco truck back there. They had the anointing of God, and that would draw the people in the church. And so, can you remember how beautiful it was? How in comparison does it look to you now? Asuren, it must seem like nothing at all. Chibazah. And you might be saying to yourself, the church might not look like nothing today. A kangri giri. Namai jire ni kangri, namai lovei, namai anointing. The zeal for God's people is just not there. And it might look like nothing. But God has a plan. Not that, because He's in full control of you, full control of the church, full control of God's people. Might look like nothing right now. But now, verse 4. But now the Lord says, be strong. Zerubbabel. Be strong. Verse 5. My spirit remains among you. He is with us forever. Just as I promised you when I brought you out of Egypt. I'm still with you. That's a word for God's people tonight. That's a word for God's servants tonight. Don't get discouraged. Don't get down and out. Don't get down on yourself. Don't get down on the ministry. Don't think about quitting. I'm here to tell you the Sogoni Tabella, whatever it is, God who brought you out of Egypt, God who brought you out of slavery, God who brought you out of bondage and into the church, He will finish you guys until the finish. Give God glory. Hallelujah. Verse 7, I will shake all the nations, and the treasures of the nations will be brought to this temple. Not done. God's money will come back in the church. The churches are a little low in attendance. The churches are a little low in finances. He will bring it back when God's anointing is here, and He's going to do it. I'll shake the foundations, and the treasures of all the nations will be brought back into the temple. I will fill this place with glory. Hallelujah. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, says the Lord. Verse 9 got me today. The future glory of this temple will be greater than the past glory.
Hallelujah.
I, the Lord, have spoken.
Amen.
What's the future glory? How could the future glory be better? The Ark of the Covenant. Fire from heaven. They would build the stones outside and bring them inside, and they wouldn't even hear a sound of the hammers. Miracles. And you can't even think of King Solomon Temple. And now God's saying, the future church is going to be better? Let me see a minister. Who's the pastors in here? Who's the pastors? Men. You a pastor? Sleepy. I'm putting you to sleep. Pastor Dan. For the men of God, and God bless you. So what you have come to digest, the future glory is only going to get better. Don't get down and out. Don't get discouraged. Don't worry about attendance. Don't worry about anything. We keep on putting God first, and He will bring the glory. He will make it better than it ever could be. And so now, why is the future glory better? Click it one time, please, Pastor. Then that the Spirit led him. Who's him? Jesus. That day the Spirit led him to the temple. So when Mary and Joseph came to present baby Jesus to the Lord, as the Lord required, Simeon was there. He took him in his arms and praised God. The future glory was there because Jesus entered that temple. When he was 12 years old, and then he cleared out the money temple. 3 times he entered that temple. Recorded. Jesus.